I still believe the MacBook Air M1 in 2025 is a pretty smart purchase. I know it's been 4 years since the amazing MacBook Air M1 launch, and since then we have the M2 and the M3 MacBook Airs, but my heart's still stuck to this. This is the cheapest, lightest, and the most useful MacBook for most of the people out there. This is the only video you need to watch if you're planning to buy a MacBook Air in 2025. Let's go. I've been using the MacBook Air for more than 2 years now, and I still do most of my work on this light beast of a laptop. First of all, let's talk about the build. We get the iconic MacBook Air wedge design with aluminium frames, a 13.3-inch retina display that's close to 1.3 kilograms in weight. It's thin, it's light, easy to hold, and the soft finish here is very appealing. And no, it's not a fingerprint magnet. Most Windows laptops in this price range don't match the sturdiness or the durability of the MacBook Air M1. And yeah, it doesn't wobble like most Windows laptops I've used. The MacBook Air also gets really thin near the trackpad, which makes it easy to rest my hand without feeling any discomfort, which is definitely a plus point. The keyboard travel and the typing experience is also great. You get a fingerprint touch ID that's responsive. And did I mention anything about the trackpad? I love it. Just love it. The gestures, haptic feedback, and the precision with which you can scroll and tap makes it a far better trackpad than any Windows laptop I've seen. And also, if you didn't know, it does not have a fan and doesn't make noise while you're working. That's pretty cool. While the M1 Air's IPS screen doesn't compare to an OLED screen, it still manages to throw really good and punchy colors. And the speakers are simply perfect. No Windows laptop I've used comes even close to the quality of the speakers on the M1. Let's talk about performance. Apple released their own M1 ARM-based chipset for MacBooks, which was miles better than any of their previous Intel based MacBooks. I've used this 2017 MacBook Air and the M1, and trust me, the M1 is a beast to say the least. Was that nice? Even after 4 years since the M1 first launched and 2 years of me using it as my daily driver, the MacBook still feels new, fresh, and power efficient. For normal to moderate users, this laptop will run smooth as butter. You won't notice lags, app crashes, or anything that spoils your user experience. The 4K video you are seeing right now on YouTube has been edited on this very own MacBook using DaVinci Resolve, so have most of the videos on my channel, which means this can handle tasks seamlessly, whereas the 2017 MacBook Air simply couldn't. For me, the M1 Air lags when I add a ton of effects, animations, and top it up with color grading. There are workarounds that can reduce these lags while editing videos, like reducing timeline proxy to a quarter and disabling the color grading track. Yup, this works smoothly even with all the images and grades in place, so it doesn't bother me a lot as of now. That said, if you found this helpful, I think it's time to subscribe to the channel and like this video. Or you could like this video first, then subscribe to the channel, whatever works for you. I'm not a coder, but I've heard that the MacBooks are considered the go-to choice for developers, mostly due to their compatibility with coding tools. Plus, the premium build quality and long-lasting battery life are added perks for professionals. And if you're worried about the M2 and the M3 MacBook Airs, yes, on paper, they are more powerful, but in reality, they are marginally better. Most people won't be able to understand the performance difference between the three generation of MacBook Airs. Go to any Apple store and ask them to show the performance difference to you side by side. You'll be surprised. The battery life was one of the best aspects of the MacBook Air M1 for me. And even after 2 years and my battery health being dropped to 91%, I still believe my MacBook Air gives me a solid 8 to 10 hours of screen on time. It's a 50 watt hour battery with a 30 watt Type-C charger. And while it's not a super fast charger, it's fast enough to get the job done. And the battery backup is so well managed that I've never really run into any battery issues. To get an idea on charging speeds, I've got these three laptops down to 20% and then charge them up to 80%, and here are the results. The MacBook Air M1 with a 30 watt hour charger took 65 minutes to charge. The Intel based 2017 MacBook Air, also with a 30 watt charger, was slightly faster, taking 57 minutes. While the Asus VivoBook 16X with a powerful 90 watt hour charger took 72 minutes to charge to 80%. Now, while the 2017 MacBook Air charged the fastest, it comes with the worst battery life of the three. On the other hand, the M1 MacBook Air hits the sweet spot. It charges fast and offers a long lasting battery, making it a perfect choice for everyday use. That said, as soon as you purchase any MacBook, be it M1, M2, or M3 Airs, or the Pro series, go to battery health in settings and check the maximum capacity. All brand new laptops should have a maximum capacity of 100%. Mine is currently at 91 because I've been using it for the past 2 years. Also, make sure optimized battery charging is always on, so your battery can age better. Overall, the battery life is amazing. I'm sure you won't run into any major problems like you face in most Windows laptops. What I love about the Apple ecosystem, provided you have an iPhone, is the AirDrop feature. You could also use it as a webcam, pick up calls from your MacBook, and after the most recent MacBook Sequoia update, you can mirror your iPhone on your MacBook. You can use apps, watch movies, play games, and do a lot more using this iPhone mirroring feature. Good job, Apple. I love my MacBook Air, but there are some negative points that need to be addressed. The first con is the 8GB RAM. Don't get me wrong, an 8GB RAM on the MacBook Air M1 series is far better than their old Intel MacBooks or any Windows laptop in this price range. I have the 8GB 256GB option, and I can make my peace with the 256GB of internal storage, as I have an external hard disk, shout out to Seagate, but the 8GB RAM is tough to neglect, especially when I'm editing long form 4K videos on DaVinci Resolve. But to be fair, Apple's target audience for the MacBook Air series can comfortably handle 8GB of RAM. Like I said before, if you're a light to moderate user, you can run with 8GB RAM very easily. If you're not, opt for the 16GB RAM option or find optimization hacks on YouTube to get your work done like I do. Or if you have the budget, just go for the Pro models. The second con I hate is the ports. While the concept of Air series is slim, lightweight laptops, I still want more ports. The M1 Air comes with only two Thunderbolt USB 4 ports and a 3.5mm headphone jack. We don't get a USB Type A port, an HDMI port, and a card reader. Take any Windows laptop and you'll see all of these ports since the dawn of time. You'll need to buy an external adapter from Amazon to sort these issues. The third and final con is part replacement and service costs. I'm sure you know that if any part gets damaged by you, Apple charges you a hefty price. My M1 Air never had issues yet, but the MacBook Air 2017 model ran into some issues a year ago, and Apple was charging me 45% of the cost I paid for the laptop, whereas my local guy got it repaired for 1/4 of that price. Super expensive, Apple. If you're considering to buy an Apple product, just keep in mind that they're super expensive to repair. The last thing to keep in mind is the replacement value of MacBooks, which depreciates much better than most Windows laptops. You'll definitely get your money's worth if you purchase a MacBook Air today and plan to sell it anytime in the future. Plus, they keep working well for countless years, so no worries. Apple has officially discontinued MacBook Air M1s, so it'll probably get 2 to 3 years of software updates at most. I'm currently on Mac OS Sequoia 15.2. If you have a tight budget and the M1 fits in that budget, just go for this. It's the best affordable laptop choice for 91% of the people out there, even in 2025. You got the 91 reference, did you? But if you're getting a great deal for the MacBook Air M2 or the M3, and you can afford it, go ahead. You get an additional Type-C port, a MagSafe charger, better video quality, edge-to-edge bezels, and better future software updates. Just remember, the read-write speeds on the base variant of MacBook Air M2 had some issues. Look into that, then make a purchase. And if your work revolves around Windows applications that aren't too flexible with the Apple ecosystem, or you want a laptop specifically for gaming, I would definitely recommend a Windows laptop. There are a bunch of Intel Evo and Intel Ultra laptops out there that offer a lot of features for the price and are good value for money laptops. But if you're on a budget and the MacBook is something that excites you, I definitely recommend this MacBook for beginners and moderate users. It's too good a deal to avoid. I hope this video was helpful. Like the video, subscribe to the channel, and let me know in the comments if you like such MacBook tech-based videos. I'll be glad to make more. See you around.